lot of interesting talks, also as a speaker, especially if you had more or less something similar last year. We gave a shorter interval this time, 15 minutes, to try to accommodate as many as possible because we had a lot of submissions, and we tried to actually highlight the open source and real-time communication, so not really focus on just few of us here. Okay, and as your presentation is approaching and you're going to be the next, it's the best to stay in this area because a lot of people change rooms and if you are in the middle, you might take your time to get here and maybe you will switch to the next presenter. Just joking. Okay, so I'll introduce the next presentation, Kids and Schools and Instant Messaging. I see a lot of people that likely have kids already in school or getting there, so that should be interesting because we know somehow we want to give them enough of the liberty, but also we don't want to go aside, so hopefully with this presentation we'll see some what other experiences. Okay, I think we are ready to start. Thank you for coming and your floor is yours.
Okay, hi. My name is Nick, and with me are Philip and Niels, who will introduce themselves in a moment. This presentation is not very technical and not very pedagogic, but its main goal is to raise awareness for some facts that we gathered when we worked with children and with schools concerning instant messaging and social networks. So, who starts with the next slide? Okay.
So, first I'm going to tell you something about the Tekkit e.V. We are probably the only free software youth organization, and we're based in Germany, but we're working internationally, like here at the FOSDEM. A very important thing about our about the Tekkit e.V. is that the Tekkit e.V. is run by children, so the children do like all work. So we are doing technical workshops around FOSS. For example, we did the Frog Labs at the FOSSCon in Bonn in the west of Germany. And our goal is to build up a FOSS community among children and to connect children, schools and FOSS projects. So now something about me. I'm Niels Redek. I'm 13 years old and I'm from Düren in Germany. It's in the west of Germany, like Bonn. I'm a student at the Stiftisches Gymnasium Düren, and my interests are to organize events, video and audio editing, go swimming, I'm playing the piano, and I do Wing Chun. My goal is to create a FOSS community for children and to help children share their opinion.
I'm Philipp Stahl, I'm 14 years old, and I'm from Bergisch-Gladbach in Germany. And I'm a student at Nikolaus-Cusanus-Gymnasium in Bergisch-Gladbach. And my interests are programming video games and playing lacrosse and the accordion. And my personal goal is to connect children with FOSS projects.
Yeah, and I am Nick. I'm a bit out of range for the children do the work part. I still do all the work, but okay. I'm a system administrator and live in Bonn. Tekkit was founded to bring, the FOSS community to children, and I hope that we will really be able to establish a huge community of that children and adults are part as well. So this interesting world is open to more and more students that way. Okay.
So now to the topic of our presentation. We conducted a school survey among around 360 students in January. The students were between 10 and 15 years old. The results in the presentation are just preliminary. The survey will continue throughout February. So what were our goals? Our goals were to find out what software and features are used by the youth, to find out what young users think about the terms of use of proprietary services, to find out what young users think about free software, and also to find to get hard numbers supporting theories of free software evangelists. But what did we expect before? So we expected that most children would not be interested in free alternatives to the services. And yeah, we thought that they won't care about their data. And we think that children should participate more in free software.
Now some results of out of scope. We are just telling you this results for completeness, but they're not a core topic of our talk today. And the most of the children use WhatsApp and YouTube. Then the half use Instagram and Snapchat. And Twitter with 14% is a bit growing a bit, and Facebook with 12% is dying. And the most students use instant messaging to stay in contact, and the half use it to stay informed about school and homework. The terms of use. We asked if the students knew the terms of use of the services they use, and 31% said they wouldn't care, 12% didn't understand them, 40% skimmed them, and 17% read them carefully. And our conclusion was that too few young people are informed about the terms of use, and proven by the results we present later is that young users certainly care about their data, but are disturbed by legal text. And we asked the students what they are bothered by, and they said that, and about the half were bothered by the operators seeing their content. About 80% were bothered by their contents being sold to advertisers and their content being analyzed. And two-thirds were bothered about automatic data collection and their contents being shown to strangers. So our conclusion is that most young people actually care a lot about their data.
So now something about how services spread. Our question to that topic was, how did you hear about the services you use? So 68% heard about the instant messaging services they use through friends or schoolmates. The half heard about the instant messaging services by their parents or other family members, and only 6% heard about instant messaging services through advertisements. So our conclusion is that peer groups have the biggest impact on software use. Advertisements are nearly unimportant in comparison. We think that software doesn't need a huge marketing capital. They just have to be open to young people, and it will be it will spread nearly from alone. So our next core topic is what features are used. Our question was how often the students use some features. So text messages and sharing photos privately are used quite often. We expected that before. But public status posts and audio and video calls are used less often, and sharing photos publicly and video messages are used very rarely. So our conclusion here is that text messages and asynchronous content sharing are the most important things at an instant messaging service. We think that audio messaging and some other fancy features are important too, but we think that it should be enough for the first to make text messages and asynchronous content able to be in that services. So now we get to a very important point, to instant messaging and social media use in school. Our question here was if the class of the student has a group chat, and the complete 100% answered with yes. So conclusion here is that instant messaging services are an important part of education. For example, you can use instant messaging. Instant messaging services like a class community, but there has to be free alternatives to services like WhatsApp for a class community.
We asked them if they heard about free software, and 2/3 have heard about it, but only 30% use it. And the most could imagine to contribute with the software they use, and 1/3 currently would. So our conclusion is that FOSS projects with a young target group should make sure to be open to them, but that 80% could imagine to contribute to the server. That doesn't mean that they would, but even if a third would do it, that was would be very good. Issues with class and school group chats. Peer pressure makes the use of instant messaging obligatory, and the services that are currently in use have privacy issues, and young users mostly are not able to accept the terms of use legally, but they are forced to do so. So teachers are uninformed, strengthen of the use of insecure proprietary apps. What we wish communities to do is to watch out for yourselves using your or similar non-free software, and remove legal obstacles from the terms of use if you have any, and be open for exchange with kids and adolescents, and keep an eye on development tools, terms of use, GitHub, GitLab.com, and so on, discriminate against minors. And we invite you about our talk, Too Young to Your Rock and Roll, later. Yeah. There's this about the terms of use and legal text.
No, wait, let me elaborate on this a bit more, because I think we have some time left. Okay. So the point here is why we decided to tell this to a room full of developers, because I think some of what you heard might not be new to you, or might not look very interesting on the first glance. The important point here being that there are many kinds of applications that children or students in general use, and there always are obstacles that are harder to overcome for children than for adults, and we really wish development communities to be open to that, to think about whether young users are a target group of the application, and to also realize that young users might want to contribute. We actually see that happen in our workshops. We really see that happen, that we use some tool for programming, some educational IDE or something, and during the workshop some kid gets around and says, hey, there's a bug, or this feature is not as good as I imagine it to be, and we did produce patches for software projects during workshops with children. But there are legal obstacles, and also some pedagogic obstacles, and if you have the resources to do, please try to find out whether it is possible for a minor to contribute to your project. Here's a hint, there's a very successful development platform for Git repositories that bluntly locks out all children. Please Please keep that in mind when you choose your tools or when you design your contribution ways. Okay. Now to some practical stuff. In Germany, we are experimenting with a software called Movim. Some of you might have heard about it. Who of you has heard about Movim? Okay. It's a free software web client for Jabber, and it is really advanced. It does not only feature chat, but also microblogging and all the stuff that everyone likes about or dislikes about social networks. Also working audio-video calls through XMPP in the browser. And we are experimenting with this to make it a solution for schools. There will be a toolkit surrounding Movim and a hosted service. And we want to say, hey, here, if you want to use social networking in your class or with your students, if you are a student or a teacher or whatever, here's a free software alternative. And it is made for use in education, and it can only also be used privately by the children. Yeah, that's very important. So, okay. I'm not really sure whether I am allowed to show the slide, but I think some fundraising is okay. Please, I will remove it before I'm thrown out, but if you want, please take a photo of this slide. It's both about contributing to, or staying informed about the topic of miners in open source. And if you want to help us and help us do more of such trips and give talks at conferences and communicate with others, we are very you are very welcome to do that. Okay. I will close this in 3 seconds. Okay. Thanks to Tarent, the sponsor who allowed us to travel to FOSDEM, especially the children who never have enough money to do such trips. You all know that it's hard for adults as well. So if you can, please clap your hands for Tarent, the sponsor that helped our kids get here. Thank you. Okay. So are there questions? We still have some minutes left for discussion. What do you want to know? What do you have to say? Also, after the talk, please do use the feedback feature. Please be kind but critical, both towards the children and towards me. And if you have questions, you can leave it there, and maybe we will publish the answer somewhere. Okay. The question was whether there are special legal obstacles when running a platform that has miners as a target group. Yes, there are, depending on the legislation. In the USA, there's COPPA, which regulates stuff like that and really makes something like that hard. And it's also the reason why services like that huge Git platform try to lock out miners. It depends on the legislation. In Germany, miners are able to accept legal terms if there are no negative legal consequences for them. No data sharing, no giving away copyrights, all that stuff. If you do not have that, and there are no negative legal consequences, then in Germany, and I can only speak for German legislation, this is safe. You also have to make sure that the platform is safe for children, but that's a That's another thing. Yeah.
At the beginning, you said one of your results was that kids are using less and less social networks such as Facebook, and then you offer something like Movim, which looks a bit like a social network. What is your? How easy is it to get kids using things like Movim? What's the adoption rate?
The question was because the use of Facebook is declining, and why we are establishing a service like Facebook then. I don't think that the feature set of Facebook or what it looks like is the most important thing why its use is declining. There was a lot of negative propaganda because of Facebook's terms of use. Everyone knows that. only few young people or even adult people know that WhatsApp is the same and everything is just the same basically. But it has that encryption thing they make advertising for. So I don't think it's the features of Facebook that that make its use decline. And the second part of the question was, what was it? It's very hard. The children in our organization like to use it and they post actively. It's very hard because, there's this peer group thing. You need to start with a small community and then they have to carry over it. We see some people, some children start using it, but we need the schools supporting it in some way also. Yeah. We should discuss this later. Maybe a huge part of it is does fit better in the legal dev room later. So everyone who is interested in the legal side, this won't be a very we are all not lawyers, so this will not be a talk by a lawyer. But all the legal stuff will be discussed in the legal dev room. Yeah. Thank you for listening.